Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, Dow Chemical Company, the Mobil Corporation, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Atlantic Richfield, and the Friends of Firing Line.
The proposal is that we ask what is wrong with the political parties, and we'll do just that, but of course we're going to end up talking not merely about such things as patronage or regional primaries or six-year single terms for the president, but about one's favorite reforms and favorite crotchets. But that's okay, because we have here, if not exactly the founder of a political movement, the godfather of a political designation. Yes, the man who founded the term neoliberal. If you ask, what is neoliberalism, the safest answer is whatever Charles Peters believes. He is, of course, the founder and the editor of the Washington Monthly, a spicy journal in which most people are likely to be criticized, which is usually not only the safest, but the most honorable thing to do. Mr. Peters is a graduate of Columbia, where he also took an MA, going on to study law at the University of Virginia. He practiced briefly and then went to the Peace Corps, founding his magazine in 1968 and going on to write several books of reformist character, usually with co-authors, the last of them being A New Road for America with Philip Keisling. Appearing with Mr. Peters is one of his sometime editorial assistants, Michael Kinsley, familiar to regular viewers of this program, even as all important matters are familiar to regular viewers of this program. Michael Kinsley became the managing editor of the Washington Monthly, went on to the New Republic, went on to become editor of Harper's, returned to the New Republic, of which he is now editor. Mr. Kinsley graduated from Harvard, did graduate work in economics at Magdalen in Oxford, and graduated from the Harvard Law School a few years later, an occupation which Mr. Peters will denounce as a waste of energy. I'd like to begin by asking Mr. Peters whether he has a package of formal administrative reforms that would affect the political parties, and if so, might we have one or two of these?
Well, I think the main thing the parties have to do is change their conventional good guys and bad guys, because both of them in effect operate on a principle of don't say anything bad about our good guys and don't say anything good about the bad guys. Mm-hmm. And for the their opposite sets of characters, for the Democrats, the good guys are the unions, for example. For the Republicans, it's management and the military. And I think what we found in the 70s is all of those groups were both part of the problem and part of the solution. And if you had an automatically anti or pro attitude toward any of those groups, you were going to be half wrong, at least. And that this is what I think brought the Democratic Party to its what I call the caucus happy mentality of the Democratic Party. The only group remaining to be recognized is the sadomasochist. And in the Republican Party, of course, that they have been committed to the good of the good of the country club set for many, many years. And there seems to be little sign that that's changing.
Well, I think that's provocative, but let it go. If it's true that 60% of the people who voted last time around are interested in the welfare of the country club set, then that's a very interesting sociological statement. But again,
could I address that just for one minute, because I think it's an important part of my point.
Sure.
I think it is true that 60% of the people are identified with the country club set, and I think that's a tragedy. I think the difference between the 30s when I was a boy and my father had just emerged from the farm to the middle class. He was a practicing lawyer in Charleston, West Virginia. He benefited in his profession by high interest rates. His old friends on the farm, his family, the people that were now poor because of the Great Agricultural Depression of the 20s and 30s, they were being hurt, destroyed by high interest rates. My father would sit at the dining room table and denounce high interest rates. In other words, he did not identify with the people above him. He identified with the people who were still down below. Now, what I think has happened, the terrible thing I think has happened in America today, is that the middle class is far, and a lot of them are Democrats, former Democrats, identify much too much with their betters. They read all these magazines about what's a good wine to drink, where should I go on my vacation that's chic. I think even that a lot of liberals like you because you sound so fancy. So they sound they're taking a step up by liking Bill Buckley.
Well, that's a little bit anfractious, but I'll try to follow
it. It makes perfect sense. If you study it, you have to follow it.
If I could make a related point, Tom Etzel, The Washington Post, has written about this, that the coalition, obviously every political party support comes from a coalition of groups, and the Democratic predominance in our political system over the past half century was a result of a coalition going from the bottom to slightly above the middle. And the potential for realignment with the Republican majority goes without any great transformation. It doesn't take any great transformation of any particular people or particular groups. They have managed to create a potential coalition that starts from the top and goes to just below the middle. Mm-hmm. And then that gives them a majority.
Well, the objective of a political party is to attract a majority. We know this. Mr. Reagan's stress on upward mobility manifestly is not lost on people in the lowest rungs, people who haven't had that ladder pulled from them, as you so graphically put it in one of your essays, which is why I suppose 40% of the people in labor unions voted for Ronald Reagan, except you, of course, you call them a vested interest too.
Yes,
and I
do.
See the sense in which
I
they
do.
Are. But let's I'm anxious to explore and ventilate everything you've said, but meanwhile, can we agree on any reforms of a kind that could actually be enacted, that could help the situation here? To say that one reform would be, don't be afraid to criticize a Republican if you're a Republican, I would agree. But there's no way that we can enact that any more than 50 years ago you could have persuaded any Democrat in the South to say something good about any Republican.
Well, clearly, I think the parties have to free themselves of these special
How?
Interest groups that have dominated. Well,
How?
The Democrats are beginning to take a first step in getting rid of the caucuses, which I think Paul Kirk is trying to do. I think there is one hopeful step with the Republicans. I can hardly believe it, but there is the provision in the president's tax reform proposal to be kind and give the poor a break. This is an incredible step for a Republican.
He must have been out to lunch when they put that in.
Right? Somebody over the Treasury got that in there.
Because Reagan hates
but
poor people.
It is in there, and you have to say that, therefore, there is some hope for the soul of the Republican Party.
Well, that's not really a reform, is it?
Well, I believe that's a major reform.
I have a very simple procedural reform that I think would certainly help the Democratic Party and also the Republican Party. Television stations in this country are tremendously valuable licenses which the government gives away free, mm-hmm.
which it shouldn't,
but mm-hmm. given the fact that it does, they should be required to supply free television time to political candidates.
You know, I don't object to that, curiously.
I'll reconsider.
It's too late now, but it seems to be plain that beginning 20 years ago, a television license should have been auctioned. And then let the person who buys it do what
he
wants.
Sure, absolutely.
With it.
But it is
too late. But it's too late. So you would favor.
It's only too late if you think of defending the interest of all those people who have profited so greatly from the.
I don't think you should have ex post facto confiscatory laws.
It's a little unfair. It's a little unfair to the people who have bought the licenses for these tremendously overvalued prices. But let me just flesh
Why
out
just a little?
Why the, I think this
Why just
would,
a little. Yeah, I'm interested in your qualifier.
I was just being polite.
Is it unfair? Oh, I see.
Yes, it's unfair.
Are you
but
following
it's
his prescribed principle of being saying only nice things about him?
No, I would say it is very unfair, perhaps, to a class of people who I don't lose any sleep about unfairness to, because they get so much fairness in the normal
these
course of
these people have had an unfair benefit. Yeah, they have had a tremendous unfair benefit over all the years.
Many of these are corporations in which pension funds are invested. I don't think because you can find a single owner who made $500 million off a particular station, it follows that the stock of all particular station is extortionate.
No, you're basically right that it is too late to do this thing right. Let me just flesh out why I think this
okay.
would help the parties.
Go ahead.
It's because the Democratic Party especially is so desperate for money that it sells its soul every 2 years to these PACs, to these interest groups, in order to raise money to run the elections. And half of campaign costs, approximately, are TV time. Now, every attempt we've made to restrict PAC contributions, to restrict individual contributions, to restrict spending, have ended up backfiring, becoming more complicated. The only hope of freeing our electoral system from this stranglehold by special interests is to make running for office cheaper. And a simple way to do that, in fact, to make it cost half overnight, would be to eliminate the cost of TV time. Mm-hmm. And you could some reasonably high-minded things in terms of saying that the commercials had to last 2 minutes and had to show the candidate and couldn't just be a lot of singing about how it's morning in America and so on.
Well, I absolutely agree with that, and I would add one more, and that is to take outlaw the manufactured television commercial, the commercial that can make by art the guy look better than he is. Now,
I think you'd have a fight with the Supreme Court on that.
Yeah. No, I don't think
don't you.
I don't think you would. Well, to my that you fall into error sometime.
Well,
the truth is that we would give perfect freedom of speech. Like Bill Buckley could get up there and say whatever he wanted for his 60-second
could
spot.
I practice?
You could not. You could practice, but you could not have any of those movies making you seem like a hero.
No little girls picking flowers.
With planes flying. No little girls picking flowers. No planes flying off into the sunset. None of those things that make you seem better than you are. But
to
your
whom?
Freedom,
to
the voter.
Maybe they shouldn't have the vote.
Your freedom to say what you want would not be infringed in the least. Now, that is where most of the money is going. It's into these manufactured television commercials that give not a true but a false impression of the character. They make Buckley seem glamorous and desirable.
Well, what are you going to do about people who are naturally fluent running against candidates who are naturally not? Are you going to make them say? Cough every minute or so in order to equalize that problem?
No, I believe someone in politics, one of the important skills in government is an ability to express one's ideas convincingly, and that carries through wherever you are. So if you're voting for someone for Congress, you don't want some jerk who can't persuade his fellows in the Congress. You want someone who can persuade. So to see him raw, see him as he is, not see him in a manufactured setting, I think enhances your ability to make a good democratic judgment.
Okay, let me try this out on you, Mr. Kinsley. It seems to me that one of the reasons we're spending so much more money, and somebody probably has the figures, you probably do, five times as much as last time, which was five times as much time before that, dating right back to the 1976 quote-unquote reform, is really, I think, that politics is increasingly being viewed by the voter as a redistributive enterprise. That is to say, people tend not to get that much excited by going into their pockets and giving you money for your candidacy if in fact you're going to vote yes or no on Panama Canal treaties. But they're going to reach into their pocket and feed you an awful lot of money if they think that you're going to make it illegal to sell guns, or if they think that you will vote for protectionism for their industry, or vote in whatever way actually enhances their own net economic situation. So could it be that the really, truly basic reform would be to get government substantially out of the business of redistribution?
Well, you're getting out of the area of administrative reforms. I do think that the most devastating comment anyone had about the Democratic Party recently was Kevin Phillips's phrase. He said the Democratic Party stands for reactionary liberalism, and what he meant was exactly this, that all the various redistributive programs that exist, the Democratic Party stands for not reducing them one iota, mm-hmm. but does no longer stands for any more creative ways of solving the social problems we have through activist government. And of course the Republican Party has shown in the past 4 or 5 years not much courage in taking on those programs. They've taken on the ones that involve poor people to some extent, but they have not taken on the middle class entitlements programs, the huge redistributive programs. And sure, I agree with you, that's one of the causes of our, not just the loss of interest in the higher questions of politics, but also the political paralysis.
Yeah, in Venezuela, for instance, they spend five times as much per capita, even though they're about 20% as rich as we are, in their last presidential campaign, for one very simple reason. The president of Venezuela is in the business of milking about $2 billion for him and his friends in the course of his 6 years in operation. So obviously one wants an investment in that $2 billion. It's like buying a stock that's heading way up. So that observation, I think, is relevant to your concerns.
Well, I think I go back to the point I was trying to make in the beginning about my father being concerned about some other group other than himself. I think what we have to have in this country, I think the party that is going to emerge triumphant is the party that appeals to the generosity in the American character. Right now, both parties appeal to selfishness, to self-interest. I think that is devastating for the moral health of the Republic. I think there is another strong element in the American character, and I think if people are challenged to serve their country, I believe in a program of national service where the rich can't bribe the poor to serve for them, as we're doing now.
As we certainly did 120 years ago.
And as I think was wrong, and I believe in what I saw during World War II when we all served together. I believe very strongly in that. I believe that you can ask people to give up benefits that they don't need, which is it's practical reforms are also idealistic reforms. See, if you made military service a matter of service instead of being paid for it, you could cut the cost of military personnel in half. That's all billions and billions of dollars. If you ask people to give up government benefits that they did not need, like Social Security for the rich, again, you would save billions and billions of dollars. So these are realistic, practical ways of meeting the deficit that ask people to be their best selves rather than to be selfish. And I think people are tired of being selfish.
Well, it seems to me that given the fact that we have a welfare state here and that there is massive redistribution, there
are not all from the rich to the poor.
The Reagan administration has really turned that around.
70% of the people who receive Social Security are in the are above the poverty line, and would be even without Social Security, I grant you that. But let me ask you this, let me put this forward to you as a straightforward procedural reform. Since we both agree, I guess all three of us agree, that there isn't really much point in the circular dollar. I mean, for you to go to, you're a Virginian?
West Virginia.
West Virginia. Well, for you to go to the capital of West Virginia to send money to Washington, to send back to West Virginia to go to you, is kind of an unnecessary round trip. So why don't we limit the recipients of federal aid to those states whose median income is below the national average?
Why the states? You're going to get all the poor people from above average states pouring into the poor. Michael wrote a great article about this one time.
Well, obviously you would wait every 5 or 6 years until the census and rejigger the problem.
I don't see the point of that. Why don't you go all the way and say we're not going to give any government benefits to people who are above?
There would be nothing to keep the individual rich states from doing all the redistribution. They have the authority to do that.
We want it to be the country as a whole. I think one of the illusions.
I think maybe you didn't understand my point.
But you want to give money back to the states, keep it in.
I'm saying that. Let's take the state of Rhode Island because I happen to remember the figure. In 1973, they sent $264 million to Washington, and got $263 million back. Now, why was that trip necessary in the first instance? Why not let Providence decide who it is that they want to help with
Why are you focusing on the states? Why should a poor person in a rich state get less federal help than a poor person in a poor state? It doesn't make any sense.
Well, because we both began by conceding that many of these dollars are simply circular variety. Let me tell you this. In 1973, the net redistribution was only 9%, i.e. for every dollar that went to Washington, only 9 cents reappeared in states other than the states in which they originated. Now, if the representatives of New York State are going to go to Washington to vote for welfare, why wouldn't they also go to Albany and vote for welfare?
But I mean, why not continue your logic further? Well, why do it on the basis of states? Why not figure out whether whether a particular city gives more money to all levels of government than it takes in, and then why not go further to households? I mean, then you're at the ultimate.
We want to go back to it.
We postulate certain political entities.
If you're saying
New York State has incoherent boundaries, you're making an interesting point to somebody who draws maps in the 16th, 17th century. But right now, we do have states, and they do have political authority. I'm asking why. If Albany wants to help poor people in New York, why it has to do via Washington? And I just think you'd be tremendously pleased by this insight, because this would mean we'd focus on, there are in fact 19 states whose income is below the national average. Those ought to be the target of federal welfare funds. And the other states, the richer states, should look after their own concerns using their own imagination to make those emphases they want to make.
Wait, these rich states, but they don't have to send their money to Washington.
How are we going to get the money for the poor state unless we get some money for the rich state from
Congress would continue to appropriate.
But where is Congress going to get the tax money to appropriate if it's not taken from the rich state to give to the poor state?
I thought you said that the generous impulses of America are in fact predominant. If that is so, then a New York legislator would vote knowing that what he was voting was not going back to Albany, it was going to Mississippi.
Well, I think you have a very keen...
That's being a sucker, and that's what the great way the American people will not do. It has to be, you have to have a fair system. This is important. So, for instance, when I think about asking a factory worker to take a wage decrease so that his company's product can become competitive, I think you can't ask him to do that unless the executives are willing to take a salary increase too, so that everybody is sharing the burden. I think everybody should share in the burden of helping the poor states, the poor people in this country.
Now look, you're making a very appealing point, but not, I think, a very analytical point.
I think irresistible.
Because if I know your favorite steel company, it's called Curley. And they went from $18 to $9 an hour, and they got a little stock. So the idea was to keep it from going out of business. But if I were a worker in a steel company, and the president was making $100,000 a year, and we've been going downhill, and somebody said, well, here's a guy we can get for $500,000 a year who's managed the steel company over there that's gone up through the roof, I would say, well, that's a very small sacrifice for me to make. By all means, I'll take a cut, and I want him to get a raise.
If the workers are all participating in that decision, that's fine.
Yeah.
All I'm saying is you can't have a system where the individual feels he's a sucker, whether it's the individual worker or it's the state, or it's people, like when I'm asking people to go into a national service. We can say that morally, they should all just volunteer. All those nice rich people should just volunteer and go in like the poor people in the military. Well, the fact is they don't. And the one or two or three guys that do feel like suckers for doing it because none of their friends do. If you give up these benefits that I want people to give up, I want us all to have to give them up who don't need them. So nobody is being a sucker.
That's really awfully difficult to take. Nobody really needs anything other than sustenance, love, and shelter, and medicine. You don't need to have a Picasso. Does that mean we should make it a law that nobody can work to own a Picasso?
Oh, no, I didn't say that.
Well, they don't need a Picasso? You said they don't need them.
But I'm not having the government distribute Picassos.
I'm surprised.
No. Only the government has to take care of people in need. The government has to challenge people to do their part toward doing that, but in the challenging them to do their part toward serving, toward giving up,
you can't make suckers out. Why does it have to be the government?
Because I think that's the role. I think we need a government to do that. Are rich people going into the military today? The answer is no. They aren't doing their part to serve their country. They have to be. There has to be a system that says, "Look, this is your fair share. We as a democratic
favorite points, but I really like the demographic setting on this, because in the South, the tradition of so-called upper-class people going to the military is very, very high.
But it's very weak now.
And, of course, in England, it's extremely high.
But it's extremely weak now.
Well, because that's in part
because... If you went to West Point or the Naval Academy, you would find out the majority of the officer class does not come from what is called the American upper class. It very definitely does not.
There's an
You use the word rich rather loosely. When do you start getting rich? 50,000, 60,000, what?
Oh, let's say somewhere around there.
By 56,000. Now, I wonder really whether somebody who's earning $50,000 a year and paying about $15,000 tax and trying to educate two or three children and trying to live in New York City, whether he really thinks himself as rich.
That question is always put when they've got two or three children. And when they have the two or three children, of course they aren't. I concede that. Of course they are.
But then, even
so, you've got to make $50,000 and have no children.
But you're saying to be rich. Well, of course, it's absurd to try to do it. But there is some point where people do get rich. And my point is, the rich aren't serving in this country; they're bribing the poor.
But even at that point, even the person making $50,000 with two or three kids, even in New York City, the question arises: in terms of government benefits, why should, for example, they be getting subsidized student loans? Why should they be getting social?
I don't think they can. If they have $50,000,
that's one of the good things that the Reagan administration has cut back on. But every time there's a fight on it, and not just from Democrats, from Republicans too. If they want to go to medical school, all medical education is very heavily subsidized in this country, and the doctors who graduate, of course, are even if they're not in the most lucrative specialties, are making far more than the standard of who's rich is who in terms of benefits is who's making more than the average taxpayer, it seems to me. If you're making more than the average taxpayer, the program that gives you a benefit regressive redistribution
of income.
The cap
average is, roughly speaking, $10,000. That would make you rich at $10,500.
For a family, it's about 20.
Well, per person. Per capita. Right. So usually, families are two people.
Right. Again, we're saying is there are people who clearly are rich and that we want them to do their part. And which they're not doing that.
Well,
we believe in a politics of responsibility. Let me take a great old conservative.
This is the royal
word. A great old conservative word, responsibility. Now that's just what I believe in, and it is a great old conservative word. It means that we are all responsible for our national community. We all have an obligation to do our part. And I believe that. And I believe that people can be appealed to.
Madariaga wrote a very famous book on exactly that point. That we have an obligation to the patrimony to give it back instead of simply feeding off it. To go to a library and start back with Thales and thumb your way through Santayana, you're getting an awful lot for nothing. What are you doing for them? If you don't have the mind of Socrates, you've got to do something else. And that means civic service, philanthropy, helping people, whatever. I agree, but in what sense are there reforms that the parties can be encouraged to adopt that would cultivate that spirit? I happen to feel that you're correct, but that you don't give the etiology of your complaints, which is really the hate America spirit that prevailed during the 1960s. And they hate the military, especially.
Well, certainly, and that was among liberals, that was a terrible thing. And we had this.
Were you born in the 60s?
Quite born.
I saw the attitude.
A little born.
Yeah.
Among the people writing for the magazine, and I was trying to get an article saying, like, what do we need for national defense? After all, we do have to defend ourselves. But the left was so hostile to the whole idea of the military that I couldn't get anybody to write that kind of article, just because the thing was that strong. So I agree, that was one of those automatic prejudices on the part of the left that I think the Democratic Party has to get over, just as the Republicans have to get over theirs if we're going to go to a broader national politics of responsibility.
Well, now, I in a book I wrote in 1973, I came out in favor of what you like, which is a year of public service.
Yeah.
But since I don't like coercive measures, what I suggested was that the presidents of the top 10 universities in America say, We won't consider an application for entrance into the freshman class, except from people who can show they've done a year of public service.
In what sense isn't that coercive?
It's coercive in the sense that an individual sets standards for his own institution. You're free to go there or go to some other institution. Now, if indeed the measure were very widely adopted, there'd still be schools that would waive it, to which you could go. But you would then develop an ethos. Mm. And the idea being that when you're 18 years old, you owe the country something. And but it's no, much I better, it's I think, to do it that way than legally.
It's a delicious idea, I think I would love to try it. But I think ultimately we're not going to reverse this. I think the country has drifted into a pattern of selfishness. Of everybody is thinking of, really, I'm not going to vote for the congressman unless he does what I want him to do or what my group. So we've got to reverse this, and this is going to be a dramatic thing, I think, to reverse it, with calls for a national service, with calls for us all to give up the benefits we don't need, and unless there is a dramatic leadership to do that. I don't think we're going to resist this present powerful tendency towards selfishness.
I agree. Very, very few people remember that John Stuart Mill, who was, of course, the great bard of universal suffrage in the 19th century, said, of course, he would not give the vote to anybody who would consult other than the common weal. The notion that you would simply vote because this particular vote helped you is preposterous. We're going to have a big Statue of Liberty celebration a few months. I just finished writing an essay for Columbia on it. Now, at the time the Statue of Liberty was dedicated, lots of Americans weren't allowed to vote. No woman could vote. No black de facto could vote. De jure could. So the vote wasn't really considered all that important. But since the vote became acquisitive in nature because of this tendency to redistribution, then the vote became valuable in simply as an economic instrument.
I have another reform for you, if that's your problem. And it sounds perverse. I think you'll like it. Free up rich people to give as much money as they want to political campaigns. And I'll tell you why this would actually serve to reduce potentially selfishness or at least the attentiveness to the selfish claims in the political system, which is this. The ironic effect of the contribution ceilings in the post-Watergate reform laws is to eliminate all disinterested large sums of money.
You're absolutely right.
The only people who have large sums of money to give to political campaigns now are the PAC managers. PAC managers could almost be fired or possibly even sued for dereliction of duty if they did anything but use that money for the narrowly focused self-interest of the groups that they're contributing. So you lose the potential for the occasional rich. I don't think there can be too many. I mean, the rich people who gave huge sums of money in the old days, I think in part they were, yes, they were serving their class interests, but in part they were on ego trips, and in part they were idealistic. Whereas the PAC people, there's absolutely no hope.
And by the way, heavily Democratic, interestingly enough. The overwhelming amount of big money gifts during the last 20 years were from Democrats.
Yeah, but that is almost completely reversed itself now.
Well, but legally it can't be done, except via PACs. Although in 1976, Democratic PACs outnumbered Republican PACs.
It was the unions who really invented the PACs, and then the corporations ran away with it.
That's right.
Of course, it's the incumbents who benefit primarily now. It's the PACs serve the interest of the incumbents.
Sure. Now, let me ask you this. Do you think that a regional primary would have the effect of broadening putting to a broader test the candidates' criteria for service? That is to say, if you go to New Hampshire, you've got to say something nice about Mrs. Loeb, right? Yeah. We've just proved that.
Right.
But if New Hampshire was simply a part of New England, and all of New England were to vote at one time, would we have less pressure put on people to make certain concessions which are kind of humiliating?
I think the argument for it is less than the argument that we desperately need something to do something about the terrible drain on the candidates that these primaries represent, the terrible cost that one after another represents, the terrible cost to the spirit and the cost to...
That's an auxiliary benefit. But do you believe the regionalization primaries would have the effect of diminishing the appeal to special interest?
I don't think necessarily at all. I mean, if you define Mrs. Loeb as a special interest, that's an extremely narrow one. But in fact, the really paralyzing special interests in our political system, many of them are precisely regional. Yeah. Are you going to be able to deregulate natural gas if the New England primary comes first? No. Are you going to be able to get rid of farm price supports, which are bankrupting the country, if the Middle Western primary comes first? No. And so on and so forth.
So the real benefit of the regional is on what the present system does to the candidates, not, I think, on this.
Well, but if those reasons were broadly enough constructed, you speak of the matter of oil and gas. Well, that's really three states, isn't it? Louisiana, Texas, and Oklahoma. But if you were talking about, say, a 10-state area, all of a sudden the consumers recognize that they got an interest in oil and gas also. And they are not necessarily overwhelmed. But if it's a straight Texas primary, or a straight Oklahoma primary, or a straight Louisiana primary, then that special interest assumes an exaggerated effect, doesn't it?
You know, after every election, since at least 1976, which is when I started paying attention, the Democratic Party forms a commission which thinks through all of this stuff, and they come up with some new set of rules, and then after the next election they decide, no, those didn't work, we ought to try something else. So I think this obsession with procedure, it's one of the problems the Democratic Party is facing, is it is paralyzed with procedure, and really there is an entire generation of Democratic Party apparatchiks who really only know about procedure, and only think about procedure, and only stand for procedure. And I think they ought to stop fiddling and start thinking about substantive issues.
Well, are you giving philosophical and moral advice, or are you also giving instrumental advice?
Oh, well, I would like to think it was instrumental.
Mm-hmm. I would too. Now, in connection with which, you talk often about Japan, and we know, for instance, that in Japan, when Sony has a very good year and they publish it, it's cause for national celebration. Here, if General Motors has a good year, or let alone Texaco or somebody, people think, oh my God, why don't we tax them some more?
Now, well, I think
how could we get Americans to revive the ethos where we celebrate commercial success?
I think change is happening. I told you a while ago about when I started the Washington Monthly 16 years ago, the getting a pro-military article, any kind of pro-military article out of a liberal writer was almost impossible. It was also true that getting any young liberal writer to write sympathetically about the subject of entrepreneurship, about which I was passionately interested in, they all looked at me as if I was a borderline fascist when I would mention that. Well, today, you can find that the bookstores are full of books. Liberal magazines are full of articles on the importance of entrepreneurship.
Those Gilda-type things.
Things have changed. Mm-hmm. Things have changed. So that this is one of the hopeful areas, like I mentioned, my one hope for the Republicans in the tax bill being kind to the poor. They certainly, with the Democrats, in terms of being more open about the real need for our real needs for defense and about the need for entrepreneurship, that is a vastly improved. That's why everybody's talking about Japan, because they've become fascinated with how are we going to get this country back on the tracks.
But you're in favor of experimenting even with protectionism for two or three years, aren't you?
Oh yes.
In order to give the automobile industry, but only
if the automobile industry, both worker and executive, do cut the price. They've got to cut the price to get the market share. See, they're finding they have to do
That is borderline fascism, by the way.
They have to cut. Well, they you know it's true capitalism.
NRAism.
It's true capitalism, right? that
and it's something that all these corporations, you're so sorry that you wish Americans would rally around. They're all for it.
Yeah. But the problem is the corporations won't agree to make the sacrifice of wages
or
and of
unions,
salaries.
Or the unions.
The unions and the corporations are unwilling to do that, and until they are, I would not extend to them that short-term protectionism. They have to pay the price.
But interestingly enough, I don't know if it's true, but I saw an ad on television the other day that said, okay, we have in effect been shrived. I don't think they put it that way, and now we can compete.
International Harvester, wasn't that?
That was one, but this is an automobile, a Ford or something, and said, okay, this costs $6,800, and the nearest Japanese car is $6,900, and we're better in respect of this, that, and the other. Now, have we, in fact, as a result, really, of a form of protectionism, keeping the Japanese cars out by quota, have we, in fact, reformed Detroit?
If they stick to these discount sales instead of their list price sales, we may have.
Well,
the fascinating thing is that some of these sales they've been having in the last have made them truly competitive price wise, and that's what they've got to do. And I think they're gradually realizing it. They said, "Well, we'll have one this fall," and then they stopped it. And then what happened to sales? Sales stopped flat in November and December. So now they're realizing they've got to start the discount offer again. I think once they understand that the permanent discount, so that they're really competitive with Japan, then we can seize back a fair market share and American industry can really hum again.
Do you think the Democratic Party is going to be the party of protectionism in the next couple of years?
I thought so a year ago. I'm more optimistic now that they...
What makes you more optimistic?
Oh, you hear less talk about
it. Mr. Reagan's veto?
Gary Hart is a
frontrunner
at the moment, and he's very much against protectionism, except in the case of the oil industry, where he's in favor of it. But apart from that, I think people have come to realize that it's not the answer that it would.
Well, but Lane Kirkland's become his big thing.
Yes, but Lane Kirkland will be much less influential in the future of the Democratic Party than he was the last time around.
You mean because of the diminishing size, because he can't live the Democratic vote?
Well, part because of the diminishing size of the union contingent in the workforce, and in part because he made the bad mistake. In part because he couldn't deliver the vote, in part because he made the very bad mistake of endorsing Mondale early on.
Mm-hmm.
And you now have the sight of the chairman of the Democratic Party begging him not to endorse anybody the next time around.
Yeah. What is it then that you see prospectively that the Democratic Party is going to do that's going to attract the neoliberals?
Well, I hope it is this program of national service that I have mentioned. I hope it is the program that's saying that there are only truly two ways we can save the money that I can see, the tremendous sums of money we need to save to meet the deficit problem, is by meeting the problem of the high military personnel cost and meeting the cost of the social, of the entitlement programs. And one, national service does the first, and the second is cutting out benefits for people who don't need them. It so happens that both of those practical needs are met by the appeal to generosity and responsibility that I believe in.
Well, of course, the tax law passed a couple of years ago imposed a tax on people whose net income is above $30,000.
That's the beginning. Yeah. That's the first step. And on unemployment compensation, they did it six years ago. And
right.
That's the same.
Now, let me ask you this. Are you going so far as to say that people ought not even to be entitled to get back the Social Security taxes that they paid in the course of their lifetime?
No, of course they should.
They should.
But you realize that's paid back in a couple of years.
But that won't be true 20 years from now.
So what I believe for all people who are close enough to tasting the present program, I believe in letting the present program go on. I believe in who are old enough that they're close enough.
They're
to
the ones who got the best deal all along.
But their expectations, their expectations have been aroused. They have made lifelong plans on the basis
sort of
one thing.
Yeah.
It would be cruel at this point when they're 64 to say, look, we're going to abolish this program. But for the rest of us, I do believe that you turn it into an insurance program against need. I think that's what all of us thought it was. I mean, up until age 50, I think that's what most people think it is. Mm-hmm. Then they sit down with some fancy financial planner and they find, my goodness, I get it, even if I don't need it.
They got a major asset.
I got an asset here I didn't even know about. But if it's insurance against need, then it's an understandable concept. We pay for auto insurance. We don't collect unless we need to collect. Cancer insurance, you don't want to get the cancer insurance unless you need it. You don't want to get it.
What do you do with Mrs. Jones, who says, Mr. Peters, this is really very, very interesting, mm-hmm. but all of my life, while my neighbor was buying Lincoln Continental cars, I was saving. And now all of a sudden you're going to say, I'm rich and she's poor. And therefore, I'm supposed to support my profligate neighbor out of my hard-earned savings, having been denied these satisfactions in the past 35 years.
As I said, with that woman who's right next to tasting it, I'm not going to take it away from her. But for those of us who are not right up to tasting it, I say change it into an insurance program against need. What we all really want to know is that if bad luck strikes us, if we are needy in our old age, we're going to be taken care of. That's what we really want to know, and I think the American people will be satisfied with that. They, just as they don't want to get cancer, they don't want to be needy in their old age. They're going to think it's fine to have an insurance program against need.
Yeah, but we don't want to make it enticing, do we, to be, quote, needy.
Well, look, this is a risk in any insurance program. This is the problem of arson in fire insurance. I do not think it will be, I don't believe that welfare makes it enticing to be needy under our current system. And I don't think a system that Charlie's outlined, although I don't agree with him completely about it, would make it enticing to be needy.
The people who want a yacht, like some of us want to have a yacht and sail around, you're not going to be deterred from making money and being on all these television shows and doing all these things and publishing these magazines and writing all these wonderful books. You aren't going to stop working because you say, I'll just stop, not work a bit, and then I'll get Social Security when I'm old. That's not going to pay for you to go around in that yacht.
Well,
so you're going to go on working hard because you want to go around in that yacht.
I see your point, and there are levels at which this would not apply. But Charles Murray has written a pretty interesting book, as we all know, in which he points out that some people are indeed enticed, for instance, to have children because of the perquisites subsidized by the government that begin to flow when that happens. So I don't discount altogether the fact that you might, looking at your exchequer, and say, okay, I either save $1,500 this year or I buy another car. One person will say I'll save it, one person will say I won't save it. We don't want to penalize a person who exercises husbandry by saying, okay, we're going to take away your Social Security.
No, but see, we under my system, that is not going to happen because we're all going to pay for it because we're all paying for our insurance against need. So everybody is going to contribute to the system because we all want that insurance against need. Our luck may fail. Mm-hmm. Those people might stop buying those books. They may say, cancel the National Review tomorrow. Yeah. And you would want that insurance against you would want that insurance against need.
Let me ask you this. Do you have any objection, Ms. Kinsley, to, in effect, indexing Social Security, by which I mean indexing the qualification of it with reference to gerontological tables? So that whereas you qualified at age 62 in 1940, you should now be qualifying for it at age 67.
I mean, based on how long life expectancy? Mm-hmm. Sure, I think that's a very reasonable idea. But I really think that
why doesn't the New Public National Review come out jointly for that? Shall we do that?
I think that it would reduce the potential persuasive effect on the readers of both publications.
Well, that's a very cynical statement, isn't it? Because you're trying to appeal to all of us.
Right.
And here you've got the editor of the New Republic, the editor of National Review, agreeing on this as a sensible reform for Social Security. It's sort of a first step. Yeah. So why shouldn't we elevate that into?
Of course,
that is
part of the law now, but it doesn't start for two decades. In the next century, they are going to be increasing. Basically, they're doing what Charlie suggests: they're going to deny it to the people who are paying the most, while giving full benefits to the people who pay the least over the course of their lifetimes.
Well, what is the exact character? What's going to happen in the year 205? I forget.
Well, I can't remember exactly. It goes up 1 month
year
per year or something like that.
But now there is a tremendous danger of a new self-interest group coming up, and Michael alludes to it. You've begun to see a lot of articles in the last year about what the burden on the young is of the Social Security tax.
And there are fewer of them.
And there are fewer of them and are paying for this fancy, yes, we have. What I'm saying is we used to be the only ones that ran them, and now a lot of magazines are running them. I'd think about 10 in the last year. What I fear there, while I want these reforms I've talked about, what I fear is a kind of new interest group of the young against the old. They're beginning to be an organization whipping. They're going to whip up the young to hate the old.
We're going to outnumber them, though, aren't we?
Well, that's it.
I feel an obligation to touch on this because everybody's been writing about it lately. How do you react offhand to the idea of a one-term presidency for, say, 6 years? If it makes it any easier for your Arthur Schlesinger's against it.
Yeah. I find it the hardest thing in the world because in the case of congressmen, and senators, I want that, all my observation says it's good for them to be running for re-election. It's good for them to know they have to go to the public and defend what they have done, explain what they have done. That's the essence of the Democrats.
But we don't let them do it anyway after the second term.
But you also see in the case of the president, that there are enough incentives to high performance on the part of the president that his place in history is so clear, so that the idealistic motives, or if you want to call it selfishness, to be concerned about your place in history, I would call that reasonably idealistic, but that is very strong with someone who gets in the White House. So that you have that as an incentive for performance, so that you don't so much need the threat of the guy having to go back mm-hmm. before the voters. So I am more sympathetic to that than to most such proposals.
So you think that his desire to please the muse of history is going to transcend his desire to be reelected?
I think you can, where you needed the desire to get reelected as an incentive for performance, where many people feel that you need that desire to be reelected as an incentive to performance, what I'm saying is that the role in history is enough incentive for performance in the case of the president.
Do you agree?
No. I think it's the 6-year presidential term is the most boring idea in politics. And
why boring?
Because it comes up every time there seem to be political difficulties. It's fundamentally anti-democratic. Basically, 4 years is not long enough for a good president, and 8 years is too long for a bad one. Mm-hmm. The whole idea is the idea that somehow it's corrupting for a president to have to worry about what the voters think about what he's doing is absurd and anti-democratic.
Well, I agree with you in terms of democratic theory, but the difference between democratic theory in the 19th century as enunciated by John Stuart Mill and what you're all complaining about so vigorously here is tremendous. What you're saying is here democracy is defined as an accumulation of single interest lobbies. And since an appeal to the commonweal is no longer a part of our ethic, of our ethos, oughtn't we try to shore up that appeal by appropriate mechanical measures? For instance, let's say a one-term senator.
Well, I think what you're saying is since democracy is having its problems, there should be less democracy. But
If democracy becomes abusive, certainly you want to limit its power, don't you?
No, you might want to.
That's what the Bill of Rights does, by the way.
What? Pardon?
That's
me?
What the Bill of Rights does.
Well,
the Constitution is a series of negative restraints, really.
Yes, I understand. But this one goes too far.
Why does it go too far, but the Bill of Rights doesn't?
Oh, the Bill of Rights is procedural. I think the amendment that limited a president to two terms is sort of an absurdity too.
You oppose that also?
Sure. But at least it doesn't contain in it the idea that once a president is elected, he shouldn't have to worry about democracy, which is the
well.
Implicit
I said, Ms. Speed has a very good point here, namely that while he is president, he's going to want to be able to pull out, as LBJ did, his little card saying 67% of the voters approve of me. There is still going to be some desire to be ingratiating with the people, even if you know that you're secure for 6 years.
I guarantee you, if there were a 6-year presidential term now with no running for re-election, you would have high-minded commissions reporting on the problem of the lame duck status from day one and how we need to change that.
Well, how come they haven't done that since the 23rd Amendment was passed? Or was it the 22nd?
Because there's so few presidents who've made it the whole route.
Well, there was.
You do hear talk about it now because Reagan's so popular, people saying, why shouldn't he be able to run for a third term?
Well, that's
I must say that while I support the 6-year thing, most of the people who are for it are people that I am against. They are basically anti-democratic mm-hmm. people. Mm-hmm. Most conservatives really don't believe in democracy. They don't believe.
Don't believe in democracy as an epistemological instrument.
Right. And in addition, what has happened is an increasing number of liberals really don't. For instance, most of my liberal friends really believe in the civil service. They don't. They believe in government by permanently tenured civil servants, mm-hmm. not at the idea of patronage, which is after all appointment by the people we elect. Mm-hmm. And seems to me to be closer to true democracy. My average liberal friend is just totally horrified by mm-hmm. that.
Well, you point out that what only 200,000 people can be appointed by the
people
can be voted by the president out of 2.8 million in the civil service.
And increasingly, this is true at state and local government throughout the country. So that in many cities, 95% of the jobs cannot be filled by the political authority. In many states,
TSA wouldn't be allowed to teach English, would he?
In a
public school.
And it's frightening. It's frightening.
Yeah.
They have all these respectable tests of what makes a civil servant. When I would want to be able to hire someone who really cares about my program and making my program work.
Do you agree with Ms. Peter on the subject of, for instance, law school, that 228,000 people per year who go to law school is really an awful waste
sure.
of tremendous resources?
You're not going to get us into a fight over this.
Okay, you agree?
Yeah.
And do you have any program for desacralizing?
Yes, actually, I hate to say it, President Reagan has made some strides in that direction by making the law less profitable a profession, certainly in Washington.
How?
There's a lot of the deregulation has wiped out whole cadres of lawyers, and also the cultural shift that Charlie was talking about has served. When I was an undergraduate, no one went to business school, which has problems of its own, of course, but no one aspired to go into business. Really, the most ambitious greasy climbers among college kids today all want to go into business. They don't want to go into law. And as these things go, I think that's a hopeful change.
However, there's been no diminution in the number of applicants to law school, has
there? Yes,
It's begun to go down.
Now, is it also true that the number of people who graduate from law school and go on to practice law diminishes, as in the case of you two?
Well,
I fear there is still, even though it has begun to diminish, I think we are making it somewhat less fashionable to go to law school. There is still the enormous problem of all these people out there who have an interest in having legal problems.
Yeah.
You know, it is a cruel fact that our most respectable lawyer friends in the finest firms, they think about running the meter.
Thank you, Mr. Charles Peter, editor of the Washington Monthly. Thank you, Mr. Michael Kinsley, editor of the New Republic. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, Dow Chemical Company, the Mobile Corporation, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Atlantic Richfield, and the Friends of Firing Line. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $3 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250.